Okay, hello to everybody. Is this working? So, you know, when I give the speeches, I actually want to talk about something interesting for the audience, but my PR department always forced me to give you a story of my career, which is the beginning of the speech. And I always get questions, what is the reason for success of my team? And I also get questions as what drives me to move forward. And I was just thinking that there is actually three things which drive me persistently. And today, they are very conveniently set to my favor. What drives me usually it's challenge, it's responsibility and guilt. And the wonderful thing about today's lecture is because I'm sick, as you can hear from my voice, I feel no guilt if I give you a bad lecture. And I feel no responsibility to give you a good lecture. And the challenge of giving you a good lecture is the only motivation for me to actually continue. So I apologize, but my voice might disappear somewhere in the middle of the lecture. I was just actually diagnosed that I have a sickness. I shouldn't be actually speaking to you today, but obviously Acronis folks will kill me if I wouldn't, which talks a lot about whether entrepreneurs are actually able to do what they want or they need to do what their team wants. Right, so my talk actually, I retitled it, Smart is Equal to Digital Future, which correlates with what you just said. So everything is digital. So a little bit about me. I was born in St. Petersburg. The important part of my early life is I was born in this wonderful city. Have any of you been to St. Petersburg? Okay, it's actually very nice. It's very beautiful. It's one of the more beautiful cities in Europe. It's very different from the rest of Russia. And I was specifically studying next to this palace, which is like Versailles. And so I guess because of that, I was lucky, even though I'm a technologist, I've acquired certain certain taste for arts from the early life. Then I went to the specialized schools in physics and mathematics, which was one of the top schools in physics and mathematics in Soviet Union. Soviet Union at that time was a little larger than the United States in population. And was equally advanced in its science. And then I went to the top science and technology schools at that time in Soviet Union, which is very similar to Caltech, Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology. It has degraded quite a bit over the past 30 years, but at that time was definitely in the top schools in the world. I've actually entered the school in 1988, still in Soviet Union. And over time, I got these degrees, bachelor's in physics, master's in computer science and physics, PhD in computer science, and then they even gave me honorary doctorate. So technically, I'm Dr. Beloussov. And, you know, by the way, I'm very often asked, like, okay, when I speak to such audiences, they will ask me, okay, why do you need all these degrees? I mean, like Mark Zuckerberg and Bill Gates, they didn't get any degrees. And the good reminder for all the people who ask this question is that Mark Zuckerberg and Bill Gates, they did not get degrees from one university, which is number one university in the world, which is called Harvard. And one of the reasons they were successful is that they actually get into Harvard, and a lot of people who work for them and who were successful together with them, they actually graduated. And so it's nice to not get a degree from Harvard. My first two companies were actually quite conventional. They were related to technology a little bit. I will be coughing as a part of my speech. That doesn't express anything. Sunrise and Rolson, we were manufacturing computers and consumer electronics. Sounds relatively simple, but at the time, we had to design our own consumer electronics. We had our own engineers. We had to design a manufacturing process and build it from scratch. And at some point, we grew to about 5,000 people and $500 million in revenue. Sounds like a lot, but really the margins in this business are tiny. And so, you know, altogether, this business has made for us less money than the software businesses we built thereafter. This business has brought me to Singapore. I first came to Singapore in January 1994. The very same businesses to open logistics and financing center brought me to San Francisco. I came to San Francisco first in May 14, 1995. And I have to tell you, at that time, I was completely ignorant that Singapore would be such a wonderful place. By now, 22 years later. And I was also completely ignorant that San Francisco was based in Silicon Valley. I didn't realize that it's very important to be based in Silicon Valley. In fact, Silicon Valley at that time was just sort of becoming super popular. It was already Silicon Valley, so Silicon was already there for many years, but it was still not a dot-com boom. I think Netscape was founded in 94, and it didn't even go public in 95. The person who brought me to Silicon Valley used to work for me before, used to go to the same boarding school as I did for physics and mathematics and later to Moscow State University. He was studying in Urbana-Champaign. When he brought me to Silicon Valley, he was telling me stories about the fact that, you know, in his university there is this guy who built Mosaic in this building, and then he moved to Silicon Valley and he founded Netscape, and it's really cool. I was not really very impressed by that at that time. I only realized this later. But by 97, this was 95, right? By 97, it was very clear, and I got involved in first business which was selling computer software here. We were exclusive distributor, franchising distributor of mid-market ERP vendor Solomon Software. And at the very same time, I brought some engineers here, and thanks to predecessor to IDA, NCB, I've started development in Singapore. It is kind of funny, but the fact of the matter is, the reason why we started developing computer software, one of this was, of course, that we've heard that it's very cool, and it's cool to build your own software products for security and maybe for financial security at that time, that's what we thought. But the other reason was that there was a wonderful grant program available from NCB, and this program required us to formalize our business plan and to create a team, and we applied for this program in 1996. We actually was surprisingly approved, even though we were complete foreigners in Singapore. We got a grant in the amount of about $500,000 over some years. We never received the full amount, but it's actually started us in software business in 1996. NCB was converted to IDA. The guy who used to run NCB at that time, Ken Wiseau, went to Microsoft. Now he's on the board of IDA, but that's how I started in software business. Now, because of this grant program, which was co-funded by Microsoft, another feature which is interesting in Singapore is that government is always involving industry in any projects they do. When Bill Gates came to Singapore in 97, they didn't find any better company to show to Bill Gates but us. We had a very small team of people, and we had no clue what we're doing, but we were using latest Microsoft technology. Bill Gates spent about 25 minutes with us. He gave a quote to our press release that our product is built on the best, has a great architecture, and that made us feel that we are the best programmers in the world. And through a series of steps, we ended up founding Parallels at that time, in the year 2000. We founded Parallels. It was called SWSoft. It was founded in Singapore, in International Plaza, up until the beginning of 2001. We had about 60 people in Singapore. Over years, it have grown to about 1,150 people, hundreds of millions of dollars of revenue, and 10,000 service providers. We sold about 5 million copies of Parallels Desktop. Any of you use Parallels Desktop here? Well, there are a few users. There's always few users in any audience. And so, also, the interesting thing is that between the other products of Parallels for service providers for the cloud, Plesk, Virtuoso, and Automation, we have about 15 million small businesses and 50 million users. And recently, we split the company into four, and we sold one piece to Ingram Micro, which is a large public listed company. I was the CEO of this company up until 2010. One thing which actually makes me proud, and people always think what we have invented, and they told me that I invented Parallels Desktop or something like that. In reality, the only thing we invented is actually containers. And today, containers are used on tens of millions of servers, and it's probably one of the most hot trends in the cloud infrastructure. And when I look at my citation index, I actually filed you know, about 100-something patents on containers. It keeps going up, so I recently realized that I'm not a scientist, but my Hirsch is actually over 20, which is quite funny for not a scientist, and it's all because of patents. One of them is focused on material science at about 36 million, and one of them is focused on anything in technology below $1 million investment, Fistech Ventures. And these funds are still operational. There are actually seven partners, including me in the funds. So six are very much full blown operational, and I'll talk about this a bit later. In 2013, however, I came back to Acronis, and I came back to operational business. And in fact, when I came back to Acronis, I was thinking that this is actually maybe 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months sort of endeavor to recover Acronis into a good state or better state and hire replacement. But by now, I decided that I will stay with Acronis for a very long time. I really enjoy it. It's in a really, really hot space, and you will see it from the rest of the presentation. Well, one thing we did is we moved headquarters to Singapore. Acronis was actually founded in Singapore. It sounds funny, but it's probably one of the largest software companies founded in Singapore. And that's what it is, hundreds of millions of revenue, 700 employees, 330 engineers, 500,000 businesses use Acronis. Any of you use Acronis? There are some people. Okay, not so many in Singapore. 5 million consumers, 30,000 partners. We sell in 145 countries and 15 languages, and our new products grow over 1,000%. So it's really cool. Now, this speech is not about Acronis. This speech is about trends. And reality is that I'm very often asked to talk about trends. When people look at my bio, they easily understand that I'm partially crazy, partially have attention deficit disorder, so I do a lot of things, and so they think I have a perspective. In reality, I don't have a perspective about a lot of things. I'm not an expert in politics. I'm very often asked about politics because I'm Singaporean, which was born and raised and educated in Russia, and I do a lot of business in US. So everywhere I'm asked about either Russia or Asia or something. I'm not an expert in economics. Just today I was asked what I think about, you know, growth of economy in Asia, whether it will continue or not. I have no clue. It seems that it should be continuing. What do you guys think? Will it continue? Right? And I'm not an expert in general topics, but I'm an expert in how to build medium-sized technology companies. I've built several companies with several hundred million dollars in revenue. That's not a lot, but it's not a little. And I'm also specifically expert in storage, software virtualization, automation, cloud, small business applications, and I have some degree of expertise in SkyTH, physics, and generally science. So there are these three trends. I mean, this is a very long presentation. I want to make it short because I'm sick, so I'm going to cut through real fast. These trends are very well known: cloud, mobile, social. This presentation was first made about a year ago, and you know, at that time, you can still talk about what's special, but you know, there are some numbers here. $200 billion of cloud services spending in 2015. Depends on how you count it, but a lot. 7 billion mobile subscribers, so everybody is using mobile. There will be more mobile subscribers than people. 74% of adults use social media, of online adults use social media, and 68% of all Americans use social media. So definitely those trends are very widespread. So it's everybody. What do those trends mean? Well, one thing which they mean is they are all based on the fact that there is a thing, there is a phenomenon which used to be called internet, which used to be called World Wide Web before, and now it's called cloud. And what is cloud? I mean, people talk about cloud computing, and in our speeches, we spoke about cloud computing in parallel since about 2006. And so it gets boring by over time, and so we like to think that cloud is dead, because everything is cloud. And the real benefit of the cloud is cloud architecture. It's a different architecture of building information technology. And what is special? So there are three things. One of them is network effect, right? And you know, it's well-known Metcalfe law. In the cloud, everything's connected. Everything can be involved. Everything, every device is connected to another device. Every device, even inside the company, is connected to another device. And any person can participate in any business process. That is very special, because the whole value of internet at some point was even exactly in this fact that this was a network where everything can be connected. And over time, it became much more valuable than proprietary networks like AOL or CompuServe or MSN, which were at that time separate because not everyone was connected to those networks and not everyone was connected in the same way. The next thing, which is extremely important about cloud, and it makes a life different, and the whole difference is web standards. Web standard is effectively enabling network effect in software that allows easy integration between different components. In the past, And you guys live in the digital world, and you live in the cloud world, so for you, you don't know. But when we started in computing, I first get in touch with Apple computer. I believe I probably first played on the Apple computer around 1985 or 1984. Imagine that. It was in a scientific lab of a colleague of my dad. There was an Apple computer, and you couldn't actually move programs from one to another, and you couldn't even use the same the same disk in one and another. One was a cassette, one was a big disk, one was a small disk. Everything was incompatible to that extent. In the cloud, everything's compatible. You can build on top. And finally, cloud is about scaling up. Cloud is about being able to scale to unlimited size, unlimited number of users, unlimited number of devices. And the more you scale, the less you pay per user, per device. With a scale-up architectures of mainframes, this was quite different. Mainframes were very expensive, and they were very expensive per user. And if you wanted to have more users, you would pay more per user, not less per user. Because scale-up architecture would actually be very efficient, would be very powerful, but it will be very expensive at large number of users, and there will be some limit. And at that limit, you will pay a maximum per user. Now, with the scale-out architectures like cloud, the larger you scale, the less you pay. And, you know, of course, one of the underlying things which enable cloud is Moore's law. We'll talk about the fact that it's also dead, just like a cloud. But it's not that dead yet. And so scalable, fast, cheap, super convenient virtualization, reduced cost. You can build very, very large projects. Anybody could build very large projects. So as a result, what we have is everyone has unlimited access to vast computing resources. Very important. It's a subtle thing, but in the past, if you wanted to build something like Twitter or something like Spotify or something like LinkedIn, all of those things, I believe, used Amazon, you had to buy servers. You have to build a data center. You have to invest in the infrastructure. And so most of people couldn't do it. With cloud, everyone has access to unlimited computing resources, which scale together. The cost of it scale together with the scale of your business, so you can afford it. Everyone is connected. Everyone using very powerful computers. This is just some example. It's outdated already, but Samsung Galaxy S6 is 15 times faster than the computer which can win chess against Kasparov. Actually, my company, Parallels, is one of the sponsors of Magnus Carlsen. Any of you know who is Magnus Carlsen? Okay, he's a chess champion of the world. But he's not quite as popular as Bobby Fischer. So he told me that, even iPhone 5 wins against him. So 10 games he plays against iPhone 5. He wins 3, iPhone 5 wins 7. And he has to, sometimes he can win 4, but most of the time he wins 3 or 2, right? So. That's very powerful. But at that time, I remember, this was about 2000-something, when Deep Blue won against Kasparov. That was a major achievement, and it's a big cluster which was required. And finally, everybody is using computer all the time. Computer is part of basic instinct. People are addicted to computers. This is just some example. This guy was publishing his mugshot, and he became a cover model. Because he got 60,000 likes on his mugshot. I'm not going to ask you if you guys like him or not. He looks okay here. Right? So this fact that everybody is connected all the time with powerful computers, there is unlimited computing resources, and not only, everybody's addicted to computers. You go to a restaurant, you see three people or four people sitting on the table. They're not talking to each other. They're talking to their phones, right? And that enabled this meta trends. Sharing economy, Uber, HomeAway, Airbnb, ClassPlus, that's one of the portfolio companies of ours, Amazon Home Services. Any of you use those services? Uber, everybody must have used Uber, right? It's great, it's quite convenient. Or HomeAway, I just recently used HomeAway, it's amazing. Or Airbnb actually is a new player, HomeAway is old player, but they are both in shared economy. Instant messengers, who would imagine? What's special about instant messengers? I've never really understood it. Before I realized that with post, we would send maybe one letter a week or one letter a day for some people, or some people with active correspondence, like, I don't know, say, Winston Churchill will send 10 letters a day. With email, I personally send 150 emails a day, right? So it's much faster, right? But with instant messages, people do 800 messages a day on the average. So instant message is just much faster way to communicate. You just send many more messages. It's much more interactive. You cannot send 800 emails a day. I send more emails than anybody in Acronis by the factor of 10. Well, but an average in Acronis by the factor of 10, or maybe by the factor of 7, but I cannot send 800 emails a day. It's impossible. On most of instant messaging networks, people easily send 800 instant messages a day, right? And so those messages are gaining ground. Any of you use Telegram, by the way? It's sort of funny question for me. Okay, there are some people. Okay, it's interesting, but both of the companies which are leaders in instant messages, WhatsApp and Telegram, are founded by people who came out of Soviet Union. So WhatsApp is founded by people from Ukraine. Jan Kalm, he's from Ukraine. And Telegram is founded by the guy who left Russia to Germany, Pavel Durov. So they are sort of related to Russia, to the country when I was born. And in fact, Telegram is slightly better because Germany is better in privacy laws. And it's growing very fast. It's about 100 million users right now. Data-driven automated education. Well, definitely a trend. It's quite clear that at some point education will be much assisted by IT. It's still an area where IT is relatively weak. Most of education is like this. It's quite manual. And data-driven automated healthcare, lots of things to do, literally to save lives. Again, this is an area which is growing very fast. Data-driven automated government, definitely something we can see in Singapore. All of those last three areas, they have to do with the percentage of people which are actively using computers. As soon as a percentage of people which is actively using computers above certain threshold, these trends become relevant. If only few people in a classroom, including schools, only few people in a hospital or being sick, only few people in a country use computers, then those three things, those three last things are not yet as relevant. And so they are becoming trends, and there will be major trends over the next 5-10 years. So what's next? Those are very known trends. And you know, again, cloud is everywhere and everything is cloud. Mobile is everywhere and everything is mobile. And social is part of our life. Social is becoming our basic instinct. Most people, if you switch off social, they feel as if they lost hearing or they lost vision, right? It's really hard. I mean, I've started to do this several times a year. I actually switch off my devices for several days. And you feel a little different. Right, but so what are the next big trends? And so here I wanted to talk about this big trends. Again, this was presented first about a year ago, and I came up with these trends even before. The fact of the matter, I present a speech very often, and the trends don't change that often. And so there are 12 plus one trends here, which are pretty obvious. One of them is Internet of Things. And this is one of the very old trends. I remember people spoke about Internet of Things as far back as 1998. Whatever, 7. So that's about 20 years old trend. It is growing very slowly, but it's accelerating now, and it's definitely already all around us. There is a lot of things around us which are connected to internet, and every day there is more and more things which are connected to internet. And every day there is more and more to do with data those things generate. And you're talking about different things in military, where it's mission critical. You're talking about automation and control in factories and smart houses. This is just some information about the trends. You know, they believe that there will be about 50 billion devices connected in 2020. That's significant change for many parts of IT. For example, it's a change for system management. You know, people used to deal with a billion devices. Now you deal with 50 billion devices. For example, it's significant change for internet infrastructure, because you have much more traffic and you have many more devices which send traffic. It's a significant trend for storage because there is so much data these devices generate. And so if you want to learn more about it, I just recommend to read this book, Silent Intelligence. Anybody of you read this book? It's a pretty good book. It's written by a friend. He used to work for Qualcomm for a very long time. Qualcomm is one of the leaders in Internet of Things area. And you know, there is another trend. I mean, I've sent this slide to him, to this guy. Well, he's on the left side, on the right side, Daniel Abadovsky. he told me that I have to talk about fog computing. And every time I give the speech, I think that I should delete it because I'm not sure what it is, but it's supposed to. Any of you know what is fog computing? It's computing on the edge of all this Internet of Things devices. Do you know what is fog computing? You're supposed to know. Anyways, it's supposed to be very cool, right? So next trend is robots. So what is really enabling robots and enabling to a great extent is one of the challenges of robots was that they needed a very powerful computers. But today, smartphones are not only powerful, but also have a lot of sensors in them. And so that really enables robots to grow much faster. Is it because they directly use smartphones, like in many of those toys? Or because they can use the same components, which are now widely available and very inexpensive, right? So this is one of the first robots, Roomba. Any of you have Roomba? So you see many, right? Two-thirds of people supposedly name their Roombas. Do you have a name for your Roomba? Yeah, that's pretty weird. That's definitely a first very useful robot. There are robots like this for specialized things like cleaning windows in high buildings or cleaning hospital yards and so on. This is another example. This is a new robot which you can use as a Segway or it can be a butler, recently released. This is a BMW which is starting to use robots in Germany to collaborate with people, to sort of give people assistance in a production line. And finally, just telepresence robotics market is expected to be $13 billion this year. In fact, I was one of the first people who bought this double, and I've installed it in my Seattle office. At that time, I was still involved in Parallels, and my employees sort of made fun of it. They put a red shirt on it, and that's my face on the robot, and it's sort of scared of me there. It's really cool. Any of you have tried this double? It's a very basic thing. You just install iPad in it, and you can basically travel all around the office and shout at employees and scare employees. Quite quiet, and so this is actually the company is growing very, very fast. They just crossed $10 million in revenue, and they're just releasing the second version of this robot, and it's really very, very simple. It's you know, just this thing below, it's kind of like Segway and iPad on top. And you can manage it from your iPhone. We have those robots installed in every office. We have one in Moscow, one in Boston, and one in Singapore. And anybody can connect and drive it around. It's not actually that widely used because it's not so convenient just yet, but I believe it would be. Trend three is drones, right? It's another very big trend. FAA finally certified Amazon drones, so Amazon drones would be used to deliver. Amazon believes that it's very important to deliver stuff within 30 minutes because it enables emotional purchases, like I want this shoes or I want this dress, and you buy it, and in 30 minutes it arrives at your place. Now this is Transport Canada, which actually released 1,700 commercial drones, they already certified. DHL is flying drones to deliver packages to the remote islands in the North Sea. Singapore Post already used drones, right? So it's announced that in October 8, 2015, drone used to deliver this package from one island to another island. I've actually gave this as an example at some point, and they told me this is not honest because the postman have put stuff on the drone, and the postman on another side catch the drone and took stuff off the drone. But this is just a matter of time before it will become honest. That's what they expect to have in U.S., 325,000 people to have registered drones. And this is an example of a drone which is built by Chinese, which can actually ride you around. So it can actually get you to travel, I believe, at about 100 kilometers per hour. I'm not sure how reliable it is, but you can test it, right? So drones are really amazing. I mean, we actually investigate in drones in Acronis to do data downloads. Believe me or not, networks are quite slow. And while we started this investigation, we found a number of startups which allow you to rent drones. And they do funny stuff. The most successful of them kind of reminds me of the Linux time. I remember at the time when Linux was popular in 97, 98, 99, there was one company which was very successful in Linux. And then, you know, another company bought it, and then I remember CEO complained on one conference, and when they bought it, they realized that the company was primarily selling penguins. So it didn't sell much Linux, but it made the toys, and people would buy penguins. So here, the drones are used to make selfies. So the most successful implementation is you pay a certain amount of money, and within 20 minutes, the drone arrives and make a selfie of you from the air. And you know, in any geographic location around that area in US. Next drone is definitely connected cars. So cars are very stupid devices, if you consider that. And in fact, they're very dangerous, right? So people are always afraid. I fly about 10 times a month, and over the past 15 years, and I'm probably one of the most afraid of flying person I know. I hate it, but planes are safe. Cars are very unsafe, right? Every one of us have somebody in a major traffic accident. And in my 44 years, I have a number of friends and some relative who died in traffic accidents. And at the same time, cars are major, huge industry. It's $1.5 trillion and 75 million units, right? So modern car produce about 25 gigabytes of data per hour. And so that's basically the connectivity market for cars will be about $200 billion by 2020 from $35 billion right now. So it's growing very, very fast. There is a lot of startups in connected car areas in all parts of connected cars, in connected motorbikes, connected cars. This is a startup in our portfolio, a very rapidly growing company in New York. The typical application is to improve the insurance coverage or improve the service coverage based on the driving information. If you can connect, if you can collect information in real time, you can see if the person is driving carefully or driving recklessly and where is it going, and you can predict when he needs service, and you can charge him more or less for service warranty, and you can charge him more or less for insurance. And this is a self-driving car. That's the next generation trend, self-driving cars. This is Mercedes on the streets of San Francisco. They promised to do in 2030. I was invited with this speech to McKinsey talk to a semiconductor industry. And there was a head of Mercedes self-driving car division. And I turned to him and I told him, it's written here 2030. Is it true? And he said, yeah, 2025, 2030, it will be on the streets. Right? So I don't know if you've seen it. It's pretty cool, this car. There is a lot of things you can do in the car if you don't need to drive it. Right? And nothing funny. You can read a book, I meant, or prepare for class. Right? So Google have actively using these cars. I believe I was told they are driving many hundreds or maybe thousands of miles every day and being tested. And so they are working. They are not so perfect, but they are working better and better. And of course, Elon Musk is very rapidly expanding Tesla platform into being an assisted driving car. So there is a connected car, there is assisted driving car, and there is a self-driving. So Tesla is very rapidly becoming assisted driving. Hopefully that will make our roads much safer, right? Huge market. One of the things which is interesting about this market, and I've recently spoke to the company which is a market leader in connected car platform, the company is called Harman. Harman Kardon, you know those, the audio, but they also make connected car platform. It's a highly fragmented market. There is really no applications yet. 50% of market, for example, is a QNX operating system, but there is a wide variety of other operating systems, and there is a wide variety of chips. 90% is ARM, but different implementation. 10% is Intel. So really, each car maker today making a connected car for themselves. In the future, I believe it will be consolidated. It will open itself for applications. And at that time, it will be great. And again, this is just cars, not counting motorbikes, and I believe not counting trucks. 3D printers. Another big trend, which is promising to change manufacturing, this is a 3D heart model. The 3D printing industry is promised to reach 5 billion. This is just an industry of making 3D printers. So really, it's not about making 3D printers. It's about what you can make with 3D printers. And there is a lot of different things. I always had this personal sort of benchmark is that if in my vicinity I meet 3D printers, like that means that if I invest in companies which do something with 3D printers or if I have customers or partners, then it becomes a reality. This is just one company which allows you to order your 3D printing copy. It's, I think it's based in Seattle, and it's a customer of one of our startups. This is an example of a very cheap 3D printer with a very good resolution, 50 microns. And this one is made in Canada. It's only cost $179, right? So it's becoming very inexpensive. When the 3D printers only became popular just yet, my wife gave me a present for birthday. I think it was about 3 years ago, of 3D printer. I never was able to make it work. It costed $4,000 or $5,000, and it was very bulky and ugly. And then I gave it to our IT department. They tried to make it work. They were never able to make it work as well. And in 3 years now, you can buy one for $179, and it really works. And what does 3D printers mean? That means that everything becomes software defined. And that also means that everything can be customized, because today you all sit on this very similar chairs, and there is a lot of components which can only be profitable if they're made in volume. If you manufacture everything on 3D printers, and there is nothing which makes 3D printers more expensive in theory to manufacture since than any other method, you can make all of it customizable. You can download your chair, modify it to the way you want it, print it, instead of going to IKEA's dead, right? And just assemble it the way you want at home. And this guy made a motorbike like this, printed, right? So, 3D printers are a funny trend. So one of my employees, he was a distinguished engineer in Microsoft, and he joined us as a CTO. At some point, we had to push him out because he went crazy with about 3D printers. He decided that he want to invent new methods of new powder for 3D printers, which would allow to print integrated circuits. And so if you can print integrated circuits, you can print a TV completely, except maybe a CPU, which requires more precise printing, but everything else you can print. And so he had all kinds of explosions in his home, and he wouldn't show up to work. I think he patented a number of his instances. They can print some very basic integrated circuits right now, but I think it's just a matter of time before you can print anything. Then fintech revolution, that's very clear that it's happening. The banking system of the world is very antiquated. It's about 600, 500 years old. The first bank I believe I've seen was in the city called Siena in Italy. That's what they call, of course, something like banks were before. It's disrupted from every angle. Lending Club IPO brought it to about $10 billion valuation. We are actually investor in a number one company in the same area in UK called Zopa. Payment space has been conquered from a variety of angles by mobile operators, by carriers and retailers. Again, it's amazingly stupid space, right? If you think about it, you have to carry those wallets with credit cards. That's stupid, right? It's enough to carry a mobile phone. It knows everything about you, and it's much more sophisticated than credit card, right? So credit card has a tiny little chip. It's very easy to forge. Try to forge a mobile phone. Much, much harder. And it's only a matter of time when it will happen. Now, of course, there is Bitcoin. Any of you use Bitcoin? Any of you done something with Bitcoin? Right. So Bitcoin is it has made a lot of splashes. But when I gave this speech first, I believe it was about, I'm just thinking, maybe 3 years ago with Bitcoin. I was talking about that this is something between a stock market and Las Vegas, right? Bitcoin. In reality, Bitcoin converted into just blockchain, and so it's separated from Bitcoin, and blockchain is very effective method of authenticating information, making sure that information is original based on distributed cryptographic proof, which allows to not have a central authority. That's very convenient. If you think about it, is that what is the problem with digital information? I've not realized it for a long time. I have to tell you, I'm very ignorant of technologies this way. So Bitcoin has appeared on the horizon, what, 4 years ago? Right? And I've only realized what I'm telling you maybe a month ago. Before that, I was not really sure. But the thing is, digital data has a very amazing and, you know, unlucky quality. It can be easily forged. You can easily copy it, right? You can never know if the digital data is, you know, is real. It can easily be modified, right? And that makes digital data not very valuable, right? So how do you know that a certain document is the right document? It can have been modified if it's digital. And so you have to keep a copy with some central authority and verify the copy that it's accurate. Or coin technology, what blockchain technology allows you to do, it allows you to do hundreds of times or thousands of times more authentications of the fact that the document is authentic. And that allows to revolutionize a lot of different parts of the industry, including financial, including healthcare, including education, including including insurance, anywhere where you need to ensure that the information is original. And so a lot of investment in this area. This is just some examples of investments which happened last year. Blockchain is not just a technology, it's also a very large framework which allows to do many, many different things. So if you haven't looked at it, I encourage that you do. It might be useful in a variety of ways, way a part of blockchain. Wearables, it's an old trend, right? So it started from, you know, that's a prediction for this, $500 million US, $50 billion in 2018. Fitbit, you know, have started a very, very long time ago, right? And then it went to about 21 million units in sales right now, and it's growing very, very fast. This is just example of other wearable from the top manufacturer of high-end watches. Gartner expects that this market will be growing at about 50%, and it's about 11.5 billion this year. So it's a large market. Any of you wear Apple Watch? You? One? Two? Anybody else? Right? So not so many people, right? So reality is that from my standpoint, the big revolution will happen is when these wearables will become really useful for our lives. Today, they don't really have the right sensors. There is a lot of research in physics and in technology to bring the right sensors into this, which can use medical level qualities of your blood or of your pulse, of your ECG, which can really prolong your life and solve your health problems. And that will similar to connected cars. So you think about connected car, well, you will think the same about connected human. So connected human will have a cheaper medical insurance and will have a better medical service, same way as a connected car. And so everybody will wear them because it will just be effectively cheaper to wear them than not to wear them. And not necessarily it will be a smartwatch. I'm not wearing a watch ever, so I probably wouldn't be wearing a smartwatch, but some kind of sensors which will measure my blood, what is in my blood and what is happening with my heart will definitely be very useful. For example, I wouldn't be sick today if I would have had one of those sensors which some of the people are contemplating, I would have been cured about a week ago. But I only did a blood test yesterday, and I only knew the blood test result today, and I will only start taking antibiotic tomorrow. With this thing, I could have been cured right at the moment when I was getting sick. Virtual reality, a very important trend, number eight. You know, it's funny, but one of the first things which we did in Singapore back in 1995, we opened a computer store in Simlim Square, right? So a bunch of Russians. And we had good contacts with suppliers in Korea, Taiwan, and Japan, and US. One of the suppliers we had a good contact with was actually a company which ended up being sold to Facebook, Oculus. So it was predecessor of that company. It was making virtual reality headgears. And we were the first importers of virtual reality headgears, exclusive exporters to Malaysia, Singapore, and Russia at that time. And actually, this was the first time when I met Singapore government officials. Gok Chek Tong, who was a prime minister at that time, visited our the computer exhibition in actually NTUC exhibition center, and we were displaying this virtual reality headgear, and they brought him to our center, and he's quite big, right, and tall, and he has big head, and for a while when he was trying to sort of put this on his head, we were scared that it wouldn't work because it wouldn't fit, right, but eventually he put it on. It wasn't very useful. It was 1995. I think about last year or the year before, the company which we were distributing was then went bankrupt, was bought by another company, which then went bankrupt, which was bought by another company, which became Oculus, which was bought by Facebook, right? So now it's becoming real. Predicted to be $70 billion market by 2020. Google Cardboard cost as little as $90, so it looks like this. You know, the guy who made a presentation for me, he said like he was trying to find photos of Google Cardboards, and apparently everybody who has it, they open it. Do you have it? So maybe it means it's amazing. Oculus Rift is set. That's the one we brought to Singapore. It looked much uglier at that time. It's set for March 28th. Anybody tested it here? You tested? How is it? Hmm. That doesn't sound very promising, interesting. I bought a Google Glass, and we actually gave it as presents to a number of people, and most of them were not able to wear it for a very long time. So Google Glass was really a bad flop. And you know, people will get headaches, and they will. Some of them will try to wear it, but would not be able to do it for a long time. So what are the use cases? Gaming, healthcare, design, customer experience, but personally, I think the main use case is communication. So I remember at some point when I actually was already a little tired with venture business, I was thinking maybe, I mean, I didn't want to go back to Acronis. It was split from Parallels, and for me, I thought it's sort of boring to deal with data. I was thinking to solve one of the problems which is annoying for me in this modern world, and this problem is that if I need to have a meeting in São Paulo with somebody to discuss an important contract, I have to fly to São Paulo, and it takes about 40 hours to get to São Paulo, maybe 35 or 36 from here. And so I arrive to São Paulo, and then it takes 4 hours from the airport to get to the meeting, and then I meet somebody for 1 hour, so, you know, 40 hours, and then I fly 40 hours back. Very inconvenient. You know, it's amazingly inconvenient in the modern technology. Why? Because in order to talk to somebody, you need to actually, you need to have multiple things. One thing, you have to hear his voice, right? That you can do. Another thing, you have to actually have high definition audio so that you hear the intonations which he uses in his voice. Because those intonations allow you to hear, the tonalities allow you to understand whether he's lying or not lying, whether he's certain or not certain, whether he's stressing something or not stressing something. So whenever you discuss an unimportant topic, you can talk on bad phone connection, but whenever you need to discuss something very complex, you need very high definition connection. Well, now in addition to that, you need to have a video so that you can see his facial expressions. Then you need to see where he looks, you need to see what is his focus, you need to see whether he looks at you or whether he looks up, whether he looks this way. Then in addition to that, you need to see what happens with his body. Did he lean back, did he lean forward? And then finally, you need to synchronize all of it in such ways that your brain can automatically understand the meaning of what the person is saying. And the fact of the matter is one of the most amazingly complex things in the world today, which is not known how it works, is human intelligence, is human creativity, And the origin of human creativity is most likely coming from the point when people needed to understand each other. So our brain is primarily a machine to understand what other humans are saying and meaning, and that means actually seeing them in action. And that's why when I need to discuss a complex contract, I cannot do it on the phone. I need to fly to São Paulo from Singapore. What happens with this, you can actually connect in virtual space, right? So you can see a virtual copy of somebody, and you know, if with the right technology, your virtual copy of you can be presented to somebody in a very realistic way. You can make an avatar of yourself, which may be a 10 gigabytes avatar, which encodes your gesticulation and facial expressions, but this avatar can only need only to be downloaded one time. And so that's why I think Facebook is investing in it, because you would be able to socialize in person with people who are remote. That's amazing opportunity. I mean, it's not good for Singapore Airlines, but it's good for me. I hate flying, right? So then big data, that's another trend which has been around for a while, but you know, frankly speaking, I only understood it about 2 years ago. This is just a good example of what big data is about. So there is this wonderful company called Chevron. At some point, not right now, that's now with oil crisis, the numbers are much worse. It had about $220 billion in revenue, $41 billion in EBITDA, and had a market cap of $220 billion. And the fact of the matter is, much of the oil it makes, it is produced from imperfect shafts, and such shelf shafts can generate about 3,000 petabytes per day on all of them. And so if they, for example, use S3 for this, that will be about $450 billion, so very expensive, a lot of data. If they use their own storage, that's outdated. I should have to update the slides, but it will be about $41 billion. However, if they are able to store all of this data and in real time open and close the right parts of the shaft, they will be able to optimize oil flow, and they might be able to improve their EBITDA by $15 billion, just $15 billion, right? So they basically can use the data to extract money. Big data is about making money from data, right? So what they can do is that they have those holes in those shafts, and these holes, they suck oil, water, and sand. And when they suck too much sand and too much water, they should close them, because it's actually making it impossible to clean the oil. But when it's below a certain quantity, they should open them. And so they should dynamically open, close those holes, and that can optimize their EBITDA. And so companies can make big profits on big data. That's not only related to oil. It's also related to, for example, car industry. You can do the same with engines. It's also related to airline industry. Most of manufacturers of engines, like such as Rolls-Royce and General Electric, they're switching to the model where they charge for the usage of the engine, and they have those sensors on the engines. As we all know from Malaysia airline flights, they're constantly supplying information to the back end, and it's constantly analyzed, and the General Electric is constantly trying to optimize how the engines work to decrease the spend of oil. And finally, this big data is becoming very useful for all of us, because one of the problems of the data in the past, all of us have a lot of data. Like I have computers since, you know, personal computers since 1992. There's a lot of data about me, but what to do with it? But with analytics, you can actually analyze it and extract some interesting sense from it automatically. Another big trend, very important, is artificial intelligence. You know, this is IBM Watson, $100 million revenue right now. So people are using it for something. They expect to be $1 billion by 2019 and $10 billion by 2024. Facebook can recognize faces very, very well. Also very important. Another major problem, how to identify that you is you. You know, if you have a proper virtual reality headgear, it will know that it's you, and you will be knowing that you're actually talking to the right person. Microsoft just bought this SwiftKey in a deal worth $250 million. So useful thinking machines are available right now. This is an example of the machine which helps people with low vision to read. But you know, that's another information. For me, artificial intelligence is about the fact that you know, most of the world today is full of stupid devices which do not learn. We use the devices, they do not learn. Artificial intelligence is not about something sort of like in Terminator movies, but it's just about making our devices smarter. We continuously use the device, we continuously do something, the device can learn and start helping us. And, you know, another big trend, which I think is one of the 11 important trends, is privacy. Privacy is becoming a major problem. And as the world is converting to digital, and again, there is a threshold. So today, we're still a lot physical, right? So a lot of what we do is physical, and a lot of what happens to us requires physical verification. As we move forward, sometime over the next 30 years, maybe 10 years, everything becomes digital. And when everything becomes digital, we completely lose privacy. And in some sense, and I'm sorry if I'm actually offending somebody's religious views, it's amazing how people 1,000 years ago, they predicted sort of a judgment day, right? Because the ultimate judgment day is when every piece of data about what you do is available, right? So in that case, you cannot hide anything because what's available about you is where you were, what did you do, you know, maybe even what did you think, maybe what was your blood pressure, maybe what was your blood contains, maybe what was your pulse at a certain point, where you looked with your eyes specifically. You cannot escape any question. Technically, the person who has access to all of your information can completely control everything you did. So you really are completely open to somebody who has this information. And, you know, it's nice when you think about, and, you know, people always think about this and they say, like, okay, NSA, as we were told by Ed Snowden, has information about all of us. But that's okay, right? NSA is usually good guys. When you see the movies, sometimes, occasionally, you see some bad guys there, but most of them are, you know, they are pro-democracy and they're nice. So they're not gonna do anything bad with us. Well, the reality is that as soon as the good guys have the data, it's already vulnerable to get to the hands of bad guys, just even because the bad guys can pretend to be good and enter NSA and get the data, but also because that if the good guys got the data, bad guys could get the data as well. And so one very interesting announcement which happened last year in August, and NSA have officially announced that they need to convert to post-quantum and quantum-resistant algorithms, that public key encryption is no longer enough, right? And all of the US government organizations, in terms of standard, they have to use post-quantum encryption or some degree of quantum-resistant encryption. What it tells us, it means that probably they can decrypt it very easily. And so that means that whatever you encrypt with conventional means, they can decrypt. You know, my friend, who is one of the world security gurus, once told me, if you forgot what you said on the phone, don't worry, it's recorded by NSA, right? So there are some cures of it, like new generation secure and quantum communication. Just recently, Barack Obama announced amazing bill, $19 billion budget for bolstering cybersecurity in federal government. And one thing which I want to remind you guys is that here in Singapore, there is this wonderful Center for Quantum Technology. Anybody work for the center here? Nobody, right? But it's in NUS, it's one of the leading in the world, and the guy who actually founded the center, he's actually one of the key inventors of quantum cryptography, which is the only private way to communicate known to science, protected by science. But of course, science could be wrong as well. It's better, though, than be protected by NSA. Right, so final trend, and I've just also learned about this trend recently, and it's quite amazing, is a trend that there is next generation computing which needs to come around. Gordon Moore have actually published his Gordon Moore law in 1965 in this article. Have anybody actually read this article here? You should read it. It's fun, right? So it's 50 years ago, 51. And he only predicted that it will last 50 years. And also it's amazing how humans are much better than anything in predicting things. not only about the judgment day, but also about such basic things like Moore law, because Moore law is already actually not working today. So in, to some extent, modern computers are not getting faster and faster and faster. And so that requires fundamental change in the architecture. So there are a number of things like chemical computing, like neuron-inspired Hive-based computing, and most interestingly, Mimristors-based computing, which is practiced, which is tried by HP Labs. You know, there is this very interesting lecture which is on YouTube. Stanley Williams gave this lecture while he was here. Anybody has been to his lecture, Stanley Williams lecture? It was given to Singapore Quantum Center, but it's an amazing lecture about the fact that modern computers are not very effective. And they're not very effective on two major counts. One of the major counts is that the artificial intelligence, machine learning, and those are fancy sounding trends since, but non-fancy sounding pattern recognition, modern computers are highly inefficient. They are very inefficient. They spend a lot of power. For our brains to recognize somebody's face, even in case a person sits very far and it's in the crowd, it takes a second and it consumes very little power. For a computer, it may take a long time and it will be very imprecise and it will spend a lot of watts, right? But more importantly, modern computers are very power inefficient. So they are thousands of times less power efficient than human brain. And human brain shouldn't be very efficient thing. If you think about how human brain is organized, if you have ever looked into any books about human brain, it does look very messy, right? So you would imagine that if you design something, it can be, you know, another thousand times better than human brain. And so we are at the time when we are moving from, you know, last 50 years of von Neumann architecture to a completely new architecture. One of such architectures could be this Z machine by HP. But, you know, there are a number of ways to go after the Moore law will expire, which will, you know, which will happen to a catastrophic scene over the next 5 years. So that's great. So that's a real trend. All of those trends represent major opportunities, you know, for the faculty like this. I guess this is probably the most interesting one. There are some other trends, such as quantum computers, right? So this is a quantum computer, which is bought by Google, built by D-Wave. It's not really a universal quantum computer, but it does do some very interesting quantum algorithms, such as, for example, factorizing numbers in a better way than exponential, which of course makes it possible to decrypt things. And this is a quantum computer which is built by Canada. Anybody know about this G-Wave? Okay, good. Well, what's good about quantum computers? I'll tell you what's good. There are a number of things which are good. So one thing which is very popular to be told to be good is that it makes it much, much better to, much, much easier to factorize numbers and to basically decrypt, right? And that makes all the world insecure. If there is a quantum computer, you can decrypt any data which was encrypted, most of the data which was encrypted with public key encryption in the past, whatever, 50 years, if you have access to this data. Well, it sounds important, not super important, but important. It also makes it possible to search patterns in various things in much better fashion. There are a lot of algorithms about pattern searching in quantum computers, which potentially enables much better artificial intelligence or even super intelligence. It also makes it possible to actually emulate new materials. And so you can design new materials with amazing properties because new materials are governed by quantum mechanics, but it's very difficult to emulate quantum mechanics with large number of particles. You can emulate them on quantum computers. But most importantly, when the quantum computers become reality, and every year there is progress in this field, quantum computers might be used for things which we don't know about. There is a lot of algorithms and a lot of things you can do on quantum computers which are unimaginable on normal computers. And of course, there are things beyond quantum computers which, when I was growing up, they looked like a complete science fiction. And if you think about it, when you read some of the science fiction of about 100 years ago, a lot of the things which were in that science fiction are actually very much reality today. But one of the things is teleportation, right? So it's probably even better. I mean, of course, it's good to convey in virtual reality, but would be nice to teleport yourself to San Paolo and teleport back, right? And apparently, it's not impossible. Quantum mechanics and modern science does not prohibit teleportation of your quantum state. And so this is some example. So Geneva researchers teleported a photon state, basically teleported the particle 25 kilometers. So, you know, after some time, you might go into such machine and booms, you are in San Paolo. And at that time, it's already very nice. And maybe time machine is next, right? Who knows? This is back to the future time machine. Again, there is a lot of branches of modern science which believe that it's possible to design the form of time machine which would allow you to go back in time and then branch out to a different part of the universe, perhaps the one where you're more lucky with your endeavors, right? So lots of interesting things can happen, and they accelerate very fast with the way how computing accelerates in the world. So how to distinguish those trends? I've asked myself this question because I was thinking that I myself have participated in cloud computing. And as a part of it, I've, you know, participated in inventing some of the things which are core infrastructure of the cloud computing, such as virtualization and containers. But there was a lot of trends which I missed, right? For example, I completely missed social networks. So I've created my Twitter account in 2009. And by that time, this was, you know, everybody who knew, they already had a Twitter account, right? And so I've realized that the trends can be separated in this sort of three main categories. Trends for startups. Saving time, that's historically what IT did. Productivity, right? So initially, IT was about productivity. Making money, profit center, you can make money on something, directly making money. And finally, satisfying primary instincts. If you find a trend which can satisfy primary instinct, it's a very powerful trend. So for a while, I did not understand what is Twitter, right? I didn't use it, and I didn't understand why is it important or why Facebook is important. But I've only came to realize that it's important when I traveled to London and I seen the speaker's corner. Right? There is a speaker's corner in London in Hyde Park where there is this people who come with boxes and they climb on these boxes and they keep talking to the audience even in case there is no audience. Because apparently there is this basic human instinct, talk to the audience and listen to somebody talking. That's a basic human instinct. And so if you create a tool which satisfies basic human instinct, it's very powerful. There's a basic human instinct to share with friends. I came up with this explanation right around 2010. And I've even hired a psychologist together with one of the investors in my company, Jeremy Levine from Bessemer Venture Partners. And he basically created the list of basic human instincts. And apparently one of the instincts he listed was collection instincts. And based on this prediction, my partner invested in Pinterest. So he invested, I remember, $8 million at $40 million post-money valuation in a company which had seven people and just a prototype and nothing else, right? So $32 million pre-money for eight people and nothing. And today, the last valuation was $11 billion. Any of you use Pinterest, right? It's kind of funny, right? So Pinterest is an amazingly stupid tool, but apparently there is a large percentage of population, especially female, who like to collect things. So it's a basic human instinct to collect. They like to collect. They have to have multiple things. And Pinterest allows to collect things. And by the way, Pinterest is even making money. And there is a lot of other humans who like to look at somebody's collections. And it's not everybody. And as you're not part of this group, you wouldn't understand it. But apparently, it's very sticky. And I think Pinterest is many hundreds of millions, maybe $1 billion in revenue right now already. Because they realize how to actually, they figure out how to realize this collection instinct. But it's very important to be satisfying primary instincts. Apparently, there are two other things which are good, but they're not good for business. It's powers and fame, right? So you can't make that much money on powers and fame. So, but other human instincts are good. So let's think about what we have. So Internet of Things is about productivity. And that's one of the reasons why it's taking such a long time. Robots, it's probably also about productivity, and it's also taking a long time if you think about it. When I was in school, I watched this movie about this robot, you know, which was invented, and then it ran away. It was on this, I forgot, do you remember this movie? Yeah, short circuit. So that was supposed to be a trend then, 30 years ago, and it's only becoming a trend now. Drones, again, what's new about drones? I mean, US Army was using drones for a very long time. Self-driving cars, also not very new. And finally, 3D printing. Those things are about enhancing productivity. So those take long time to take up. You know, it's moderately better to use those things. But you know, one thing which is good is one day pick up that they could be really big. Then making money, fintech revolution clearly is about making money, and it's growing very, very fast. You can make money on money and big data. Again, growing very fast. Many companies will not be competitive unless they use big data. You look at many companies in manufacturing and everywhere else, and they're all needing to leverage big data to stay competitive, to be able to be as efficient as others. But there are a number of trends which are about humanistic. Wearable, as soon as it actually helps you with your health and with your life longevity, it becomes about human instinct, and everybody will use it. And so it makes sense to look at the opportunities in this field, because once it take up, it will take up real big. Virtual reality, human instinct. People want to communicate. People want to have friends all over the world. My daughter, you know, when she was 15, had 300 friends from all around the world. I don't think I had so many friends in person, you know, when I was her age. That's because of social networks. So virtual reality can allow you to meet those friends in person. Artificial intelligence could be very much about basic human instincts on many circles. Safety, security, privacy, not yet, right? So people don't feel threatened. And this is very subtle change. You will feel threatened the first time your privacy will be lost by you. You will feel threatened. I've actually lost my privacy several times in the networks, and so I feel very protective of my data. But before I did it, I didn't care. And when I was talking about privacy, I'm actually very, very, it's my favorite trend, privacy. When I was talking in different panels about privacy in the past, say, 5 years, people said, I don't care, you know, I can open my data to anybody, right? I don't have anything, anything private. But that's actually not true. There is a lot of your data which you would want to keep private from a lot of people. And you're just not really realizing what happens if even your close ones, even your loved ones will know everything about what you do during the day or during the email and so on and so forth. And finally, next generation computing could also affect our human instinct. And so those trends could be very big. There is a bit stretch about artificial intelligence and next generation computing. I think partially we put it up there because there was no space down there. But I believe actually they will affect basic human instincts. Important thing is when you think about your startup or when you think about evaluating somebody else's startup to join it or to invest in it or to partner with it, even in case it looks strange, you should think whether it actually fits into one of those categories. And the higher it is in the category, the more likely it will be very successful. So quantum computers can be all of this at the same time, right? It will eternity. So I was thinking about this, and I was thinking about this evolution. So, you know, tools made us humans, right? So, you know, people commonly perceive to be different from apes by the fact that they produce tools in mass. Mechanisms enable the modern industry, like this is a Gutenberg machine, right? Then electronics, right? So the next trend was electronics. This is a calculator. Software-defined stuff, that's where we are today. Everything's becoming software-defined. But I think next big trend in this evolution is machine learning. And I've already touched on this. If you think about it, most of programs and devices we have today, they are smart, but really they are stupid. After we use them for a while, we do a lot of things with them in a certain sense. They don't really think very much about the context they're in. They don't know that much about us. And there is a huge opportunity to integrate machine learning in every device and in every program and make those devices and make those programs not just convenient and usable, but also smart, and make them learn the context in which they're used and the person in which they're used. And that's where you get this huge investment in artificial intelligence of Google and Microsoft and Facebook. It's because future of IT and future of technology is in smart devices, smart keyboards, smart word processors, smart, smart everything. Now, that brings an interesting discussion into place, and whether smart means replacing humans. And you can read a lot of, articles everywhere about it. And so you can think about those concepts, consciousness, free will, thinking, alive feelings. Funny enough, as a physicist, I always thought those conscience are artificial, right? Now, as a modern technologist and computer scientist, I understand that they are very, very real. And when you move to the area of artificial intelligence, at the point when you make an artificial being, you have to sort of program those things, right? And some of them are well understood, like consciousness. And you can talk about whether dogs have conscious. I mean, there are some researchers, they say they do, and some researchers, they say they don't. And can you make a robot which is conscious? Not sure. And then you have a question, what is human intelligence? And this is one of the main and most interesting topics in modern science, because really people don't know how human brain operates. And really people don't know how human intelligence is. And there are very different views on this. So this guy on the left, Ray Kurzweil, anybody know this guy here, right? So he has a very popular blog. He believes he figured out how to create a mind. So he created this book, How to Create a Mind. And so he really believes that human brain is a hot, wet Turing machine. And he figured out how it works. It just needs to be made more complex, and then it will come alive. Then this guy in the middle, he's a professor of MIT, Scott Aronson. And he wrote this not that simple book, but I recommend that you read it since you are studying here. It's exactly written for guys like you. It's about quantum computers, but it's for computer scientists. It's all called Quantum Computing Since Democritus. And in this book, he sort of takes an intermediate view. He sort of says most likely human brain is hot, wet Turing machine. So it's a computer. It's a classical computer, maybe complex one. But it's not so clear, right? There is lots of things which are not so clear, right? It might be that it's more than a Turing machine. It might be that we could not really know what it is. And what do you think? Is it a Turing machine? Do you guys know what is Turing machine here? So do you think it's a Turing machine? What do you think? No, not a Turing machine, right? And so here is this guy on the right, Roger Penrose, right? So he's in Oxford. He's more of a mathematician slash philosopher. He's one of the better complexity theorists as well. And he believes human brain is beyond quantum computing and, in fact, larger than universe, right? So human conscious is sort of much more complex than universe. And the laws of universe are all part of our human conscious, right? In fact, the guy who wrote the middle book here once asked Roger Penrose if he believes that human brain is a quantum computer or classical computer or post-quantum computer. And Roger answered that most obviously it's well post-quantum computer. And all of those guys are very renowned scientists and very renowned technologists, some of them. And they wrote this wonderful book. I recommend that you read them. When I started in science, thinking about science, that was also something very puzzling for me, and it's still puzzling for me how human brain works. If you think about it, that's sort of the most complex question. My personal view is that I believe that humans are universal knowledge creators, and they are very special. So far, we don't know anything which is more special in the universe. And that is allowing to formulate the principle of optimism, which is well described in this book. Have you read this book, The Beginning of Infinity by David Deutsch? Pretty good book. I recommend that you read it as well. Is that all evils are caused by insufficient knowledge. And so technology, which we will invent even over the next 50 years, will not replace a human mind, but will only extend the human mind, will allow the human mind to become much more effective. Now, you know, if you think about this, we come back to Singapore, and we come back to Smart Nation, and I've, while preparing to the speech, I read why Smart Nation, and I've read that Singapore have all these challenges, urban population, urban density, aging population, healthcare, mobility, energy sustainability, and that those trends are actually very modern for common world. And I believe that the wonderful thing about the trends I described, all those trends are required to solve those problems. And all those trends are moving towards the direction of solving those problems. And so if we look at Singapore 30 years from now, we will have everything connected to Internet of Things. We will have robots everywhere, drones, self-driving cars, will drive us everywhere very fast without traffic jams. Everything will be printed on 3D printers. We will not have banks, right? Fintech revolution will kill them all if monetary authority will allow. Singapore's special that way, right? Nothing happens without government allowing it. Wearables will be on all of us, and it will prolong our life. We'll live well over 100 years. We will all communicate all over the world without traveling with virtual reality. Big data will make our life and economics and industry efficient. Artificial intelligence will make things very smart around us. We will be completely digital, yet we will keep our privacy and control our privacy. And all of this will be enabled by next generation computing. However, for me, it comes to one trend. And this trend is that smart future is digital future. So everything becomes data. And so from that point, I formulated this, my own definition of singularity. People talk about these trends, and people like Ray Kurzweil and many other people talk about singularity. And so they define singularity in a variety of different ways. I define the singularity in my way, and my way is that digital world will become more important than physical. So today, well, think about it. I'm 44. When I sort of realized that I'm a person, right around maybe 35 years ago, most of the world was physical. There was almost no digital world. There was no digital money. There was no digital anything. Today, a lot of the world is digital. I think 35 years from now, most of the world will be digital. Physical world will become less important than digital. Your digital assets will become more important than physical assets. And that's a big change. And so if you think about physical worlds, there are these four things which are basic necessities: air, water, food, and shelter, right? And I think that as every personal business process will be conducted with data, and there will be more and more data, it will become more and more valuable, data and data protection will become one of the basic human needs. So losing your data will be equally bad to losing air. You will not be able to function as a person, as a professional without your data, as a business without your data. Many businesses today already cannot function with data. If Singapore loses the data of monetary authority of Singapore, Singapore economy will completely collapse, right? It's true even in case we are talking about some of the large banks. But it's not yet true for very small companies, and it's not yet true for individuals. It's just a matter of time before it becomes true. And, you know, I was thinking about data more and more as I came back to Acronis, and then I was thinking about that data is actually super important. If you look back right around 6,000 years ago, there was this first, or one of the first organized civilizations on Earth, Egyptian civilization, right? 6,000 years ago, the pharaohs invented this way to eternity. They built these pyramids. Any of you been to Egypt? Been to pyramids? I've never been. Studied them a lot, but never been. They build those pyramids, and they store effectively digital data about themselves plus their DNA, right? Imagine 6,000 years ago, they kind of figured this out. So they would store stories about their lives. They will store basic objects about their, lives. And then they will store their mummies, which will keep their DNA. And to some extent, it served a purpose because they wanted to stay alive forever. And they kind of did. We know them. We don't know anybody much of their era except them. And technically, at some point, we might be able to restore them, you know, to extract their DNA and to make a person out of it. And then we extract them, and when we take all the digital data which they store, which is very, very few fragments of their lives, we can even sort of put some personality in them. And, you know, of course, if you come up with the artificial intelligence the way Ray Kurzweil wants, we can actually even directly program them. So they will behave exactly like pharaohs of that time. And so I was thinking that, data is not just about life. It's not just about continuing business, but it's also about eternity and even about resurrection. If at some point people will invent artificial general intelligence, it will be possible to resurrect somebody like him, and you will not see the difference, right? He will be programmed, and he will behave exactly like this. I mean, he will move his leg exactly like this. He will say exactly the same words and exactly the same jokes. And, you know, in some ways, if you can preserve his conscious in a computer over a long period of time, you can even restore his conscious, right? And so it's very, very important to do data protection. So use our products. Don't lose data. Everything which stays about you is not your photos and not your, you know, belongings, but the data about your lives and the data about your professional lives and the data about your businesses. I'm crazy about data protection. I have a tattoo about Acronis. I really want to stay in Acronis for the rest of my business career and build it into our first $100 billion company with headquarters in Singapore. So we have very, very aggressive goals. Data is a unique field, which is one of the fields which is not having a global leader today. It's a huge market. Many hundreds of billions of dollars are spent on storage and storage software, but there is no clear leader. There are a bunch of old companies in the space, such as EMC, NetApp, Western Digital, Seagate, but they're all not doing really well. There are a bunch of new companies. There is nobody with large market share, and we want to build one. Singapore was always very good in storage. And so there is one more thing which I want to say. Do you want to change the world? Right now, you don't need to leave Singapore to change the world. Singapore is rapidly becoming extremely good in that sense. When I first came to Singapore 22 years ago, there were universities here, but they were not in top 100, and they were not scientific universities. They didn't do world science, and they didn't do world-class technology. Today, they do, and not only, but there is Acronis, and so you should definitely come and join Acronis. We're building R&D here, which builds new generation storage software. We're collaborating with all the research institutions. We intend to have 100 to 150 people in the core R&D here in Singapore. Very important, our R&D here is not a satellite office, it's a core R&D. That's a headquarter, that's where I'm based, and it's most advanced research, which is conducted here. If you don't want to join Acronis, you can bring your business plan to Runa Capital and Fistech Ventures. We both have presence here. Runa Capital is $300 million under management, invest $1 to $15 million in a round. And Dmitry is a partner who looks after Singapore. Olga is a partner who works in Fistech Ventures. And Fistech Ventures invest from $0 to $1 million. These are two sister funds or brother funds, depends on how you want to call it. And has about $30 million under management. So join Acronis or bring your business plan to Runa Capital or Fistech Ventures. Thank you.
Dr. Beloussov, your business is data protection. And
storage software, more precisely, but data protection, okay.
Okay. And but protection, doesn't it have more than the part that you have been dealing with? You're keeping the integrity of the data, but that makes it extremely attractive for someone to come in and have unauthorized access to that data. So in that sense, you are not providing complete protection. And I noticed that in the presentation, there's no mention of this unauthorized access of data. How about that aspect of data protection? Do you have any plans to enter that arena as well?
So generally in IT, all of the areas of software, they somehow intersect, right? So there is security, and then there is data protection. So we protect data from the standpoint of control who accesses the data, we encrypt the data, we make sure that the data is not lost, we make sure that we can take the control back, but we do not control the security. There are security companies like Palo Alto Networks or like Kaspersky who provide tools to secure the networks or secure the devices. It's slightly a different scenario. Of course, there is some intersection. So whenever you use our software, whether you use it on-premise, whether you use it in the cloud, whether you use it from our data center, we have a lot of tools which we use to ensure security and to control unauthorized access. But the main way how we deal with it is we try to not know whose data it is and encrypt all the data, so not know what's written in the data, and not even know which pieces of the data belongs to whom. So for us, the ideal storage is a storage where we keep blocks, and if the bad guy comes to us and say, I want the blocks of this guy, we say, well, we don't know whose blocks are ours. Just here's all these blocks. We would only know if the person who comes and shows us the key, then we can find the blocks of this person. And even when we find the blocks of this person, we wouldn't know what's written inside the data. So he can take the data, but it will be difficult for him to deal with it. Of course, you never know what is possible for NSA, right? So it's under some scenarios, NSA and the Chinese and the Russians can decrypt everything on the fly. But from my standpoint, in most cases, it's safe. It's too expensive to deal with that complexity.
I have a question about the data fragmentation. You know, I've got 120 apps on my phone, and it's growing, and we've got all these businesses are going to be handing out data. How do you see the future of the data management in terms of how do we, as consumers, get control of the data? And so,
That's actually a very good question. So,
if one of the companies loses data, how we actually make sure we are safe?
Right. So there is a lot of things which are sort of embedded in this question, and this is the things which we're trying to solve with our software. So first of all, we believe that there is with digital data, there is only way to make sure that your data is safe is to keep multiple copies, because if you keep one copy, by definition, you can lose it, no matter what you do, right? And when you keep multiple copies, we believe there is a way to have a single place where you keep copies of all of your data from all of your devices, from all of your cloud services. And in that place, you not only keep all of this data, but you also keep up-to-date references where you get this data. And we believe that we are such destination, or one of our partners are such destination. So you can have your data everywhere, but there will be a place where you have all this data in one place. And in that place, you can search the data. You can find the data you've lost. You can find different copies of your data. Also, if you want to, for example, delete the data, and that's actually a very important topic, because in a lot of cases, you may have some piece of data about yourself which you don't want other people to ever see. But in what you described with data across all devices, you don't know where you put it, right? It might be on this device, you know, various synchronization services, which are very conveniently built by various companies, will synchronize it to multiple places. And so you can find all the links to that data and actually delete the data securely from all of the devices. So the way we see it is that there is a production data which is spread all over the world on all over different devices, and then there is a single place where you have all of the data about you. And and that data is, by definition, is sort of not active. Active data on your devices in the cloud, not active data in backup and archiving storage. And in that place, you index it, you can search it, you can delete it, you can restore it if you need, and so on and so forth.
Okay, Dr. Beloussov, thank you for your speech on data and how important it is in today's society. I got a quick question. Actually, I got a lot of questions, but I think I'll just try to pick this one because of relevance. I noticed that the idea of the importance of data backups and stuff like that, right, seems to be more of a, less of a technological problem today, but more of a public education issue, whereby people don't seem to understand that they should just pay a few more extra dollars, like your products, to protect their data. And then when things really get really nasty, they lose their data and they regret a lot. Does any research done by a company corroborates that fact?
Right, so that's a good question, but I don't think there is any good answer to it. People are generally very irrational species, and they do all kinds of strange things, right? They don't sleep, they don't eat well, they get fat, they get thin, they drink, they use drugs, they fight with each other, they kill each other, and so on and so forth. And I think, indeed, as data will become integral part of human life, and that's rapidly becoming so, people will feel that it needs to be protected. And then indeed, when something happens to them, once they lose something, they would later keep things protected. It's just a matter of time. Of course, education is also important. But then there is another thing, is that if you look at the, if you look at data protection space and storage software space, the way it will be structured over the next 10, 15 years will change. And one of the changes is that protecting will be part of storage. So as long as you use proper storage, your data will be protected. The question will come more to recovery of the data, and the question will come more to the management of protection and storage and recovery of the data. So data management and data recovery will become an issue, not protecting the data. Protecting will become an embedded part of sort of the global infrastructure. I'm probably confusing you, but bottom line is that people will get to it, right, over time. We are a little bit small today, and we have a little bit small market share to educate the whole world. At some point, when we gain momentum over the next years, we might take on such task, but not just yet.